It's getting harder and harder to find parts of the world that remain unexplored. With the advent of satellite imagery, we've now reached a stage where you can see practically every inch of the globe from your own web browser. Yet even still, there remain some parts of the Earth where few humans have ever visited. And some of the people who have ventured to these far-off regions never return. In this episode, I'm going to tell you about one of the most remote and beautiful places in the world, the Nahanni Valley. But despite the incredible scenery, this valley in the Canadian wilderness has a deadly reputation. That's because multiple people have been found murdered there. And not just murdered, decapitated. Which gives the valley its other nickname. The Valley of the Headless Men. If you're looking for a place that's both beautiful and isolated, you'd be hard-pressed to find a better spot on the planet than the Nahanni National Park. The roughly 11,000 square miles of pristine wilderness is part of the Mackenzie Mountains region, located in the Decho region of northwest Canada. The word Nahanni comes from the indigenous Dene people, and it roughly translates to the people over there. The people the phrase alludes to were another group known as the Naha, who, according to legend, weren't exactly the friendliest sorts. The Naha lived in the mountains and would sometimes raid lowland settlements, murder a bunch of people, then retreat to their caves. In more recent years, the park was designated a UNESCO World Heritage Site. And one look at it and you'll understand why. The land contains a breathtaking array of geysers, lush greenery, and canyons, all lying in the shadow of the majestic mountains jutting up all around. Here you'll find Virginia Falls, a massive waterfall 315 feet high. That's roughly twice as high as its more well-known cousin, Niagara Falls. Winding through the Central Valley is the South Nahanni River, which over the millennia has managed to carve four major canyons through the landscape. In fact, the river is such a powerful force in the area, it has become a prime example of what is known as an antecedent river, which means it actually has maintained the same course it had even before the mountains formed around it. As a result, the mountains pretty much follow the ebb and flow of the river, rather than the other way around. Despite how breathtaking the scenery is, much of the Nahanni National Park remains unexplored to this day, due to a lack of any tourist accommodations and the fact that there are no roads leading into the park. You can only get there by plane or by taking a boat up the river. But even despite how remote the place is, there has been some human habitation there. It's estimated that the first native tribes settled the area going back at least 9 or 10,000 years ago. Many superstitious natives tended to avoid the place altogether, having long made up their minds that the area was haunted. Folk tales tell of the demons and evil spirits who inhabit these woods. Those who did inhabit the region, like the native Dene people, would often tell cautionary tales of mysterious creatures who lurked in the vast forests, or of the violent and deadly Naha tribe who lived in the mountains. It's hard to say whether the Naha really existed or if they were just a folk tale. They were said to be a tribe of fierce warriors who wore terrifying masks and adorned themselves in strange armor. The tribal warriors were said to be larger than normal men, and they were also described as carrying strange and powerful weapons, unlike anything anyone had ever seen before. Oh, and two more things about the Naha you should know. One, that they used those weapons to decapitate their enemies. And two, that one day, the entire tribe is said to have suddenly and inexplicably disappeared, never to be seen again. European fur traders were among the first Westerners to make their way to the valley back in the 18th century. Word spread quickly about this lush green wonderland and about the vast riches that were just lying there untouched by anyone. Rumors began to spread that there was gold in them thar hills. Many miners moved into the region looking to stake their claims along the South Nahanni River Basin, or just passing through on their way to the gold fields of the Yukon that had opened up during the Great Klondike Gold Rush, although very little gold was ever found in the Nahanni Valley. That didn't stop the rumors from spreading about the supposed vast gold reserves just waiting in the mountains for the right miner to find. A few miners returned to civilization with stories about finding nuggets of gold as big as their fists. It was at the start of the 20th century that another, more disturbing legend began to emerge from the Nahanni Valley. In 1908, two brothers, Willie and Frank McLeod, outfitted themselves for a mining expedition and headed into the mountains, only they never returned. At first, it wasn't considered particularly unusual that they weren't heard from again. Most people assumed they had likely run into the usual sort of trouble that could befall a couple of wayward adventurers. The valley could be treacherous if you weren't careful. It was full of sinkholes, jagged rocks, and any number of wild animals that could have done the brothers in. One rumor sprung up that the two men actually had hit the mother lode, and that they were actually living like kings somewhere else in the world with all their riches. But all those possibilities proved to be untrue when about a year after the McLeod brothers vanished, their bodies were discovered along the river. They had both been decapitated, and their heads were nowhere to be found. That story would have been disturbing enough on its own, but just a few years later it happened again. In 1917, a Swiss prospector named Martin Jorgensen moved into the Nahanni Valley looking to make his fortune in glory. He built a log cabin for himself and set up a small mining operation. It was believed that Jorgensen generally got along well with the natives. That is, until one night when his cabin mysteriously burned to the ground with him in it. They found Jorgensen's skeleton among the ashes. Well, most of it anyway. Jorgensen's head was missing. In 1945, yet another miner was found dead and decapitated in a sleeping bag. Once again, his head was never recovered. Over time, the region gained a number of rather descriptive nicknames. These included Dead Man Valley, Headless Creek, and the Funeral Range. Although the one that seemed to get used the most is the Valley of the Headless Men. Around the same time that Martin Jorgensen was killed, another trapper named James O'Brien went missing. He was later found frozen to death in the woods. And at least in that instance, he still had his head attached, but that doesn't make his death any less unusual. You see, O'Brien was found frozen to death, still clutching a pack of matches right next to a campfire pit. Some of the people who discovered his frozen corpse thought it appeared that the man had been flash frozen within seconds. The valley seems to be something of a paranormal hotspot. Besides all the strange deaths, there are thought to be at least 44 people who just up and vanished without a trace throughout the wilderness between 1901 and 1969. Many people have claimed to have seen strange lights in the sky. Others talk about some of the cryptids they believe stalk the woods, including a type of prehistoric bear dog called an amphicyonidae, which is an animal thought to have gone extinct back in the Pleistocene era. This particular cryptid also sometimes gets tied into another native legend of a massive wolf-like creature called a wahila that the Dene believes lives in the woods. Of course, being the remote wilderness that it is, there's also a legend about a hairy man ape. This particular breed of Bigfoot is a creature called the Nukluk, which is supposed to stand around 5 feet tall and sometimes is even known to wear clothes. Oh, and apparently they whistle. In 1964, a man named John Baptiste was on an expedition into the valley when he and the members of his party allegedly encountered a hairy man-like creature fitting the Nukluk's description, before the creature darted off into the woods. According to the story, Baptiste and his party continued to hear a strange whistling noise coming from the brush around them as they attempted to track the creature. According to the Dene, that whistling sound is the hunting call of the Nukluk. Yet another strange thing was once found in an ice cave called the Grotta Valerie. Inside that cave were found the skeletal remains of over 100 doll sheep, who appeared to have starved to death around 2500 BC. As a result, the cave has earned a nickname of its own, the Gallery of Lost Sheep. Many theories exist about who or what is responsible for all the beheadings, disappearances, and other strange events throughout the valley. Some people say that the valley is cursed, and that the spirits of the Naha tribe who were known for beheading their victims still haunt those mountains. In fact, the Dene people didn't think the Naha were people at all. Rather, they thought they were some sort of evil creatures who acted as the point guard for the demonic forces that cursed the valley. There is one theory some people have put forth about the Naha that brings them a bit more down to earth. Some people have suggested that the Naha might have been a lost tribe of Vikings, which, if you think about it, doesn't seem quite so crazy. Viking artifacts that predate Columbus have been found in various locations throughout North America, indicating that they may have reached the continent long before other European explorers. If natives from the Dene tribe encountered a group of Vikings wearing helmets, armor, and carrying traditional Viking swords and other weapons, it's possible they could have mistaken them for monsters. It should be noted that many Vikings believed that if an enemy was decapitated, then they would be denied entrance to Valhalla. Other theories exist about the Naha Valley having a secret entrance to the so-called Hollow Earth. The concept of the hollow earth is worth its own episode, but in short, it's the idea that the earth is a hollow ball, with a vast and alive underground world lying just beneath the earth's crust. If that's not fringy enough for you, there is yet another theory that suggests the area is home to a thin spot between dimensions, and that all the people who have disappeared have been whisked off to somewhere beyond. More earthly theories suggest that the strange deaths and disappearances might have been the work of hostile tribesmen, or perhaps even a murderous miner out to protect his claim at any cost. If you look at the span of time between the known deaths of 1908 to 1945, the idea that some crazed lunatic could have been living in the woods murdering people doesn't seem quite so outlandish. As for all the disappearances throughout the region, as I mentioned, this is a fairly treacherous area, full of unexplored caves, extreme weather, jagged rocks, wild animals, and sinkholes. There are plenty of ways for a person to get killed and vanish without a trace that don't involve evil spirits or interdimensional portals. To this day, the Valley of the Headless Men remains largely unexplored. Most geological surveys of the area have been done by air, and for the most part, only fortune seekers or adventurous rafters have done much exploring of the region. And while it is believed that beneath those mountains there could exist huge warrens containing underground hot springs and vast cave systems, if anything unusual does exist beneath the earth, it's likely to remain a mystery for a long time to come. Thanks for tuning into this video. If you have any thoughts on what's happening in the Nahanni Valley, drop me a comment below. And if you like this video and want to see more spooky content like it, click the video on the screen and don't forget to subscribe. Thanks again.